Welcome back, Wash of Walk-Ons fans, episode 334 of the podcast. We left Kevin high and dry today because Kluver can't record this evening. And when the guy who runs the whole shit can't record, that means we got to record earlier. So that's you. You run everything.
I do run everything.
But you set it up, and then you edit it, and you record it. So if the guy who runs everything can't record it at a certain time, we just got to go earlier. Does that statement stand?
It does stand. But who else can't record tonight?
Who?
You.
Oh, no. I'm home tonight.
You're the one who said earlier in the morning, you're like, I'm going to have something in the evening. I'm going to be.
Yeah, but the thing is, then my plans changed and I got empty, dude.
Wow, somebody fell through on you, huh?
No, it's just I'm not going down to Kaylee's family's 45 minutes down and 45 minutes back tonight when I have to drive to George's and train tomorrow morning to then drive 4 hours east across the state to go on family vacation with the exact same family I would be going an extra hour and a half to see tonight. Yeah. So I know that Nate, her brother, really wanted to see my dog, and I'm sure his wife also did because they have a German Shepherd from the same breeder that we got Bane from.
Same one.
Same breeder. She's the reason we got Bane is because his brother and his wife went to this lady who has been breeding German Shepherds for 3 decades. And this lady is in St. Louis is the reason that both Nate and myself have our German Shepherds. I'm sure they wanted to see Bane, but I just don't feel like taking him down there
today. There's absolutely no reason to go 45 minutes one way and back when you're about to spend a whole week with
them. Right.
I'm surprised that you ever crossed your mind.
I really, really enjoy hanging out with the young ones. Like Kaylee's sister has 3 kids and then Nate has 1, and all 4 kids are just really sweethearts. And so they're fun to hang out with. And I would have gone down there to see the kids, but I'll see them tomorrow.
You're Daddy Drake.
But see, here's the thing. I've always been this guy, right? I've always been everybody's favorite uncle, even though I'm actually an uncle to nobody, right?
Allegedly, yeah.
Everybody's favorite uncle is Uncle Drake because I have no rules. I don't enforce your parents' rules. And I always have good jokes. So, like, what else do the kids need, right?
I have no rules, and I don't enforce your parents' rules. That's what this is going to be called, Uncle Drake. Uncle Drake, Wash Up Walk-Ons episode 330.
So I didn't even finish this intro.
Yeah, keep going.
I'm still in my introduction.
Okay.
And to finish my intro before I was rudely interrupted by the guy who runs the whole shit, the reason Kevin cannot be here is because, did he say his nephew?
I didn't even think he gave a reason.
Yeah. Young nephew got baptized this weekend. Oh, that's why he texted me and said he wasn't able to watch the final round of the British Open this morning, which was crazy, because his nephew got baptized. So hope everything went well there. Hope he did not get fondled by a priest. Hope they got all that original sin washed off there. And we're all good to go for the future for the next generation of wards. That's what we hope. And here's to that. So episode 334 is kicked off. And Kluver, what do you got?
You go from Kaylee's nieces and nephews are sweethearts, saying that word for word, to saying, I hope Kevin's nephew doesn't get fondled by a priest.
Is that a bad thing to hope? Should I hope that he does get fondled by the priest?
Like, the fucking dichotomy.
No, I think I should be hoping for exactly what I was hoping for. Everything to go smoothly.
This is unbelievable. How did we find ourselves to a point in our life where this is the kind of shit that we talk about?
Because Kevin didn't get to watch the British Open this morning. I don't know.
Holy smokes. Have you ever seen the video where they dunk the baby?
Yeah. Just absolute shacked his head right into the pool. I've seen the baby get dropped.
John Cena'd into a fucking pool of holy water.
I'm pretty sure just for TikTok views, one dad hit his kid with the RKO.
An RKO baptism. That's what Manders is going to do. He's going to... Have you seen some of the videos of Manders lately?
You know, I actually pretty well checked out after I watched him headbutt a chair until he bled.
Yeah.
Yep. I did that in college once, and I was an absolute lunatic, and I was also hammered on beers. So, like, that's what that takes as a human being, to headbutt chairs until you... I didn't even make myself bleed, Kluber, and we all know how much of a lunatic I was. Manders has lost all of it.
He's
out of every part of his mind.
And I thought that I had seen him in another world, in another universe, another human inside of the flesh and bone that was his body back in 2014, 15, when we were running game simulators. He's gone to a whole new level. It's all he does. Every match he's in, he's either smashing those big, long, skinny light bulbs on somebody else. He's throwing someone through a table that's wrapped in barbed wire. I saw him get body dropped onto a metal chair the other day, and the chair didn't give. His body lost that one. At one point, you know, they had him tied up in the ropes in the corner, and someone stuck a bunch of like needles into his heel. So I remember back when DJK said he was going to write a book. Back when we were in college, he said he was going to come out with a book of like all the shit that he had to go through, whatever. And then
he said he was going to come on this podcast too.
I think he said he still would. We just never followed through with it. Kevin absolutely wants nothing to do with it. And to be honest, I'm not sure that I have the mediating ability between you and him. I don't know where that goes. I'm a little scared.
Oh, I love it, dude. Just think about the fucking fire and gasoline.
I do think that it would be a hell. I mean, the numbers it would do.
Numbies. We would do some numbies.
Talk about a bump.
Put it on Patreon. We get like 17,000 subscriptions one month. That all
every Hawkeye fan on Earth subscribes to us. They're like, we got to hear it. I got to hear it for $8 a month. Got to fucking hear it. I can cancel the subscription after the end of the month. Got to hear it.
$8 to hear this conversation between this psychopath and this fucking lying, losing cunt.
Is that our next move? Is we start going after like the high profile guys, controversy. We start going after coaches and current guys, but we put it all behind the paywall.
Hey, dude, you know I'm always up for a good altercation.
Holy shit. You're so right. Like, I actually think that we could have a in-depth. Now, I don't know. It's on him if we get into a conversation with DJK to give us the truth or his truth or what he remembers.
I want the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help me God.
Hand on the Bible. That would be something. Somehow we've come to this point where...
Dude, we don't have Kevin. I don't know what we're going to talk about. We just had Dickhead Friday, Saturday.
Dickhead Saturday. Well, let's talk about the... you and I will find a way, dude. We'll find a way. Don't worry about it. I actually hit up Keith right before this. I was going to have Dunk come on.
Yeah, that would have been fun.
Because last night I went to an event that he helped put on, and I'll talk more about that in a second. But... quickly on the Patreon, I want to give a shout out because we're getting a bump anyway. No DJK episodes, but we were hanging out at a certain number. I'm not going to give away numbers, you know, but we were hanging out at a certain number and we're up like 20, 25 Patreon walk-on army members in the last month.
Welcome to the squadron.
And I think that this is sort of the trend as we get closer to football season. People get a little bit more interested. We're going to start talking more current Hawkeyes, right? I've got a couple grander, larger topics for us to dive into as we creep near the season. We're under 50 days now. So that means the content is going to shift towards legitimate black and gold. It's not just going to be the black and blue, meaning the ugly stuff that Drake and I come up with, or Kevin we got lucky. Caden Proctor commits. I don't even think we ever talked about Charlie.
We genuinely got luckier with the recruiting this one year than we have in all other years combined. We've talked more about recruiting this offseason because cool shit has happened. And
right.
A pretty sick team shaping up over the next few years. We talked about recruiting more this offseason than every other episode combined.
Yeah, we didn't really give a shit. It's probably a product of us getting further away from the program, because when we were in the program, our level of care about recruiting was zero.
Actual zero.
Didn't care. Couldn't have told you a single name of a kid that was coming in the next class.
Yep.
Any of the years that I was there. It's so crazy, the echo chamber that you're in. And I don't want echo chamber gets a probably a negative connotation that comes with it. But in the sense of Iowa football, you are so dialed in that you don't even give a shit. It's just like, yeah, you're fighting for your own spot. But as we get closer here to the season, more Hawkeye content going to ramp up. Also, I think people are starting to understand the kind of product we're putting out behind the paywall on Patreon.
Telling you, we're having fun over there, folks.
We put
that
out
Discord, that Discord availability, that's worth $8 a month.
And that's what I like to say to people is that, and I hope that it doesn't come across like we talk about this all the time, but it's like once we start that community and we start to curate conversation on a deeper level with our listeners, it's hard not to talk about the cool stuff that we're doing over there. I don't care if you sign up or not. I don't give a shit. I do have a baby coming in December, and every sign up, a couple bucks goes my way. But hey, I don't care if you sign up. Diapers and daycare are fucking expensive. I'd love for you to hit the button, but I don't care if you join the army or not. Inflation.
The kids do, though. I'll tell you what. Those kids are getting sweet Christmas gifts. They care.
But what is happening over there is we just locked down an unofficial official sponsor, basically. Drake and I, our entire diet is basically shifted to CBD gummies. But you don't get the code. You don't get to even know the company if you don't come over to the Walking Army.
You don't get the 25% friends and family discount.
No. Shout out to our guy, Drew. The Discord by itself. I mean, you could pay $8 a month and you can get personally shit on by Drake.
Whenever I please. Some mornings I just wake up and I say, let's check the Discord and see who's going to get this steamy one that I've got rolling.
Right. Like who is asking for the smoke today?
Today.
Sometimes it's great conversation. Sometimes we get into deeper stuff. Sometimes there's some like behind the scenes shit that.
And there's like 14 different chat channels, and I only check out like 3 or 4 of them. I leave some of them to the people.
And some of the people still complain that there's not enough. They're asking me to make more. I'm like, what? What do you want from me? The Discord by itself seems to like pay for itself. Then you add on top of it that, sure, you get the Monday, Thursday episode, but Drake and I do another episode every single week, and we don't talk about anything football. We literally talk about all of – I mean, I talked about shitting myself almost in a marathon.
Great story, by the way.
Right, and that will actually debut Tuesday because we recorded it yesterday because Drake's going on a family vacation. Nonetheless, the Patreon's growing, and I wanted to give the shout-outs where they're due. And I'm just going to go back to July because I haven't done this in a while. Actually, I'll go all the way back to someone who named their Patreon account Fuck You Scott Frost.
Woo!
So you obviously
I'd love to see that one in the Discord.
Nathan, Paul, Travis, Trevor, Clayton, Leland, John, Patrick, Kendall, Caleb, Matthew, Carl, Peyton, Tyler, Joshua, and Billy Boy. I don't know if that's if your name
Billy Boy.
Billy or not. It, probably Bill. All of you are brand new to the Washed Up Walk. The Washed Up Walk on Army in the last month to 2 or 3 weeks. And we are thrilled to have you. Not only are you going to get the extra episode, get to participate in the Discord, you're going to pay for your membership with the discounts in merchandise that you're inevitably going to buy because Hawks buy a million and that's what it is. New stuff coming soon.
And those couple of Patreon exclusive pieces, pretty choice.
You also have access to specific pieces that that nobody else gets. A couple of people were pissed that they didn't get in on the fully tented, and that's your problem.
I got in on it.
You did. You did. You happen to be part of the company, this three-person company that we call a company, but it is what it is. So you actually got them for free. I last night attended what was it even called? A kickoff dinner.
Football?
No. This is a Keith Duncan thing.
Duncan kicking?
Keith Duncan kicking.
Shout out to Big Dick Dunk.
Who has partnered with a charity called Count the Kicks. I was not asked by this charity to do this. I'm simply doing this because it actually is pretty relevant to me. I actually had a great time last night at this event that Keith put on. Corey Taylor was there and gave a speech, and he is involved with this charity as well. And I decided that we're a little low on content today. We're missing one of our three wheels on this tricycle, so we could use a little something extra to talk about. So I'm going to highlight this because it actually can be a great way for you guys to, if you don't decide to donate to the walk-ons and the children of the Children's Hospital, this is another way that you can help kids out financially. It's called Count the Kicks. Count the Kicks. I've heard of this. I had seen Keith posting about this for a year or more. He's been involved with this. Had no idea what it was about until last night. Keith texted me a couple weeks ago. He goes, hey, on July 16th, 6 to 8, Saturday night, we're having a sort of a kickoff dinner or charity dinner to kind of highlight what this is all about. Tori's going to be there. A bunch of his high school athletes from around the area were there, and they've all got this thing going on where they can, based on their performance, kicking the football, punters as well, people who decide to donate per good kick, right, per extra point or per field goal that they score, the money continues to raise as they kick more and more field goals and punts and stuff like that. And so it's a cool... And I didn't understand, like, okay, kick, every kick counts. What's the charity for? And then it clicked when I actually was there and I was listening to them. And my computer wouldn't let me pull it up for some reason. So I'm going to read it off of my phone. Every kick counts. Paying attention to movements helps expectant parents get to know what's normal for their baby and speak up if they notice a change. Essentially what this is in... And I'm going to botch this, so I'm sorry to this organization, but every kick counts. Everykickcounts.org. Just go there. You'll learn more than you are going to from my dumbass. Essentially, what I got from this speech was, in the third trimester specifically, Lauren and I are in trimester two, so it's on the horizon.
You're looking at trimester three starting right around my birthday.
Yeah, a little before.
A little before?
Yeah.
Your birthday?
Yes. Yeah, right around my birthday. Obviously, at some point, the baby starts to kick. Everyone knows this. You can feel the kicks from the outside. It's like, holy shit, what are they doing in there?
That little avocado ain't kicking yet?
It's a bell pepper this week.
That little bell pepper ain't kicking yet?
We're at, 18 weeks as of today. So They say, I think it's like right around 20.
Oh, so your baby's a little slow is what you're saying. You got,
no,
you got a little Tyler Kluver in there.
No, because at our last ultrasound at the 16 week, the doctor was like, holy smokes, it is moving around like an acrobat in there. And so I thought, you know what? It's doing CrossFit in the womb. Knew it. Already taken after dad. Can't say that's always a good choice, but hey.
Let's hope he makes better choices in the first 26 years.
It wouldn't be difficult. It wouldn't be difficult. In the third trimester, babies start to kick. They have a predictability to that, right? A certain baby will kick every so often per hour or whatever. This is an app that allows you to track their kicks and then sort of keeps it on the front of your mind when if your baby is not kicking as much as it normally is, especially if it's significantly off the number of kicks, it's a way to prevent stillbirths. Like, you can contact a doctor, you can go in. It saved a ton of babies' lives.
And so Keith associated with this app, right? He didn't create this app.
No, he didn't create it.
I was going to say, he's about to be a bazillionaire.
Right. But every kick counts. Obviously, it makes sense. Right. And so now they've partnered with kickers, and it's just like a win-win.
Oh, that is sweet.
And the way that they, yes, it's crazy cool. So the way that they make money is you can pledge per point. I've got Tori Taylor's profile up on my computer right now, and it says basically, I'm excited to turn my stats on the football field into a win for the community by becoming an every kick counts athlete, and I hope you're willing to help. During the upcoming football season, I'll be raising money for Count the Kicks, a life-saving stillbirth prevention campaign of the nonprofit organization Healthy Birthday, incorporated by Count the Kicks, teaches expecting parents about the importance of tracking their baby's movements because every kick counts. This campaign is very important to me. Count the Kicks has saved babies in 26 states and 3 countries, and I am proud to help make a life-saving difference. Please support my effort this coming football season. So you can go and donate to Tori, which is probably going to be, for this podcast, a whole lot more significant to a lot of you. There's also a bunch of high school athletes that have a profile on this website as well. And you can donate a fixed amount if you want to, or you can pledge $1 for every point or $10 for every point or whatever you want to do. And then based on Tori's performance, the better he does, the more money he raises for this organization.
So how much are we pledging?
Well, that was the thing. I almost last night during their speech, they were like thanking people who had given, like,
bro, you should have just big dicked it. You knew we had the money, you should have been like, bro, we got 25 beans right now.
Well, I don't know.
And just cut the check. 25K on the spot. Boom. And I mean, everybody's face would have been on the floor.
Dude, I really thought about from the back while Keith was speaking, going, the walk-ons are in for $5,000. But I didn't do it. I pussied out. And the reason I didn't do it was not because we're not going to give money to this, but it's because I didn't want to take away.
I'm good with you not. But at the end, you for sure could have just,
I know,
cut him a check.
Walked up there with a big old, like, that would have been funny. I just wanted to mention it. You can also see who's donated. It looks like Henry Marquez has pledged a point per $1
per dollar per point.
Yeah, so.
Shout out Hank
and Jack Kerner's mom, a couple other people. So I just wanted to bring light to that. The other thing I wanted to bring light to, and I'll be very honest, I knew nothing about this organization or what it was other than Keith invited me to a free meal. Right. And so I went because I heard free meal. Now, then I found out that it was Estella's, the place in Iowa City, the burrito place that every guy in the team who has Black Card, my brother included when he was on the team, said there's not a better burrito place that they've ever had. It puts Poncheros to shame. And Estella's was there. They are a sponsor of Every Kick Counts, a partnering sponsor, and they donated their services and their taco bar, their taco slash walking taco bar last night. And I ate so much that I almost got sick. I was piling guac and queso and shredded cheese and sour cream onto mountains of deliciously seasoned shredded chicken. And if we could get
steak.
It was beef or chicken. I came home. My stomach was gurgling for 3 hours because I ate way too much. But it's my first experience with Estella. It was a 5-star experience. And I can't wait to actually go and get a burrito hot and fresh from them. They're not paying me either. It was fantastic, and I've heard it was great, so I was pleased with the experience. So I wanted to bring light to all that. If you guys want to help donate to Tori Taylor or just the charity itself, go to Every Kick Counts or countthekicks.org. Search one of those, and you'll find it. Okay. Now that we got that out of the way. This podcast, I do want to warn people that this podcast is taking a turn quickly. So we just went from charity, and we're going to go to the other side of the coin here. In fact, let's cut a break right here. I'll throw in the advertisements post-talk, and we're back. Okay. Extortion.
Whoa. You.
What comes to mind?
You.
Me?
My money.
No. I would never. First of all, I'm not extorting you. That would be embezzlement, I think, is what you're talking about.
Listen, any bad word for what somebody could do to somebody else, you do.
I don't see. You paint this picture of me that I don't think is fair even in the slightest. It's really bullshit. Like, if people met me, there is like the, he's kind of like he's way too obsessed with CrossFit. Okay, that comes across in the podcast. But they would also think, hey, he's kind of funny and seems like a good guy. But on the other side,
seems like it.
But on the other side of things, you have people thinking that I'm the least funny asshole. Because you tell me I'm not funny on every show, and every other show, you claim that I embezzle our money. I'm going to start
doing it. That's his facts.
I'm going to start doing it. it tracks. Hey,
you ain't had a job in 3 years, yet you got all this fucking fancy equipment.
Not true.
You got Pelotons, and you're just embezzling. You're just embezzling money from probably multiple companies. You're a tech guy. You probably wrote an algorithm that siphons money off other companies' online books.
Dude, if I knew how to write algorithms or computer code, I would. Life would be easier.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true.
I should have done it. Now, was my level of participation in college to the degree that it would have needed to be for me to pass a computer science major? Not even close. Do I think if I actually dedicated myself to learning that I probably could do it? Yeah, probably. But here we are. We're 27. We got a kid on the way. Probably not going back to school now. And
so who are you extorting?
Not me. Penn State football.
Yikes.
And you're going to want to buckle up for this one. Penn State, as you guys know, Penn State, not exactly the richest history of being a clean program. Old Joe Pa, Jerry Sandusk.
Extort me, you.
Penn State athletes say woman extorted them, threatened to make sexual images public. This was written 2 days ago.
Isn't that blackmail?
Two unnamed Penn State student athletes told police they were extorted in the fall by a woman who convinced them and other athletes across the country to send sexually explicit images and then threatened to publish them online.
Isn't that just blackmail? But extortion and blackmail mean the same thing?
Well, because we're low on content juice for this specific episode, let's pull up some actual definitions. Extortion is the practice of obtaining something, especially money, through force or threats. Blackmail is the action treated as a criminal offense of demanding payment or another benefit from someone in return for not revealing compromising or damaging information about them. So it sounds like extortion is specifically money. It just says obtaining something, though. They're basically the same thing.
They're the same thing.
Yeah, similar blackmail extraction.
So some hua got these dudes to send dick pics?
Probably a guy, honestly. Using fake images of some porn star, guaranteed.
And we know a lot of our former teammates who would have sent that pic.
Yeah, 100%. 100%.
So it happened.
Oh, if it happened. I continue. Two unnamed Penn State... more than two dozen videos and photos were sent to this woman that included videos of group sex and videos recorded in the Penn State football locker room.
Yikes.
Depicting athletes in various stages of nudity, university police wrote in the warrants. Five male athletes who were not suspected of committing any crime other than being way horny. I love the fucking meme on Twitter. The bonk meme. Oh, God. Have you ever seen that? It's like the horny police have showed up. Excessive bonking.
Like, I have not seen that.
Oh, God. None of which who were suspected of committing a crime were reported to have been extorted by the same woman who was not identified. At least one met the woman on a dating app, while another was contacted through Snapchat. The woman, police wrote, told one man that she likes doing this to athletes and planned to expose him. A link to the images was posted on a handful of public Instagram accounts in September. At least one of the student athletes disclosed the information to the coaching staff in the university's athletic department, which assisted in having the accounts removed. Now imagine this conversation.
Coach Ferentz, I need to speak with you. No. You go to, how am I going to forget her name? Who was his secretary?
Oh, fuck. Rita.
You go to Rita and you say, Rita, I need an emergency meeting with the head coach.
I don't care what's on the guy's schedule. Fit me in now.
And then, you know, hey, Coach Ferentz.
Oh, God.
Can you imagine? I know you've warned us a lot of times about, you know, numerous stories of these hooas out here.
Oh, shit, are
all sorts of trouble. But I sent my wee-wee in, and it's all in, and I need help.
Oh, God, I cannot imagine. Oh. Hey, coach, I gotta talk to you after practice. Oh, shit, all right.
Sure. I need to talk to you before practice.
Honestly, right now. can I pull you over here for a second? Oh, shit, what's going on, Clue? Coach, I like ass, coach. It's been a while.
Dry season.
You know how it is, coach. Camp goggles. I cannot believe this is how it went down. It's been a while, coach. I got a little loose with my communication over the cell phone. Some pictures were exchanged.
Video. I was jerking off, coach.
Drake and Kevin are in the pictures too.
My face is in it.
We need help. We're in fucking trouble. It's like that. It's like that video of Doug from The Hangover. Hey, we fucked up. Oh my god, taking that to KF or any of the staff. Holy shit! I can't imagine. This is where it gets better or worse, depending on who you are. She tweeted a response of a link. No, she straight up tweeted a video response to one of James Franklin's tweets last fall. So Franklin, Scuba Frank, Turtle Man, tweeted a tweet. This fucking account replied with a video of his players doing something in the locker room. Like, oh shit. Sexually explicit videos and photos were also shared with coaches and their football programs in Alabama, Florida, Minnesota, Mississippi, and Missouri.
Yikes.
I feel bad for these guys. They're being targeted.
This is all one broad.
Supposedly.
One broad got him in like 12 states.
Yeah. She was going after Bama, the Gators, the Gophers.
Oh my goodness.
Either it was a broad or it was a fat Cheeto finger dude with a little wiener using pictures of supermodels to fake an account. Dude,
I'm actually not all right after this story.
It's what I mean. What a wild story. Somebody
don't
sent this.
Get got with your dick in your hand. She tweeted a link at Franklin. What a gangster.
Just doesn't give a fuck.
I mean, you thought I was ruthless.
Yeah.
This chick has no soul.
None. So there wasn't much more to the story. Evidently they found some sort of resolution to the case there. I don't know exactly what that was. It seemed a little vague in the story as well. But what a development from Happy Valley. Sandusky
strikes again, dude.
Might have been him. Got a text from Connor Kane the other day. He was listening to our episode about taking over the NIL club.
Yeah.
And he was like, dude, he was shooting off all these ideas. He's like, screw doing it for other schools. Just stick with Iowa, but then do it for all the athletes. Like, set up an entire platform for the tennis players, for everybody. And just like go all in on the Iowa brand and all this stuff. He's like, you guys have the ability. You don't have any filter. You can do whatever you want. You guys are the LIV, the live alternative to the NIL club. And I was like,
talk dirty to me, Connor. But also, like, don't be sharing our info, dude. We got to get this shit done before we share our secrets.
Seriously.
What are you waiting on?
Well, there's nothing we can do now. They're locked in for a year with that thing.
Nah. We'll buy them out.
How are we going to buy them out?
They'll just give back their money.
That's not
going to happen. Contract.
I know that it released on Friday, and within like 4 hours, they'd already sold 30% or so of the passes. So, you know, in the end, regardless of who's behind the idea and who's actually cashing in on the take right now, it should be us, god damn it. I am happy that because this was just not a thing and now it is a thing. Like, it's just an extra $400,000. Those guys are taking at least 10%. It's an extra $360,000, assuming that they sell out, as a pool of money for these guys to just, like, think about that. Over the course of the entire football team, they just added $750,000 to the team's net worth for those guys to go and buy Estella burritos or, I guess, bottles at Summit.
There's No. Those are for free.
Well, yeah. That's true. That was the funniest. I'm going to cut that.
Doesn't exist anymore, though. That died with us.
Yeah, I mean,
it really doesn't.
Now that players are getting all this NIL money, people are going to start asking for more. They're going to start trying to get theirs. Oh, man.
I thought that was a jihad for a bottle. And you're like, a jihad?
You're like, what? And they're like, I saw the deal you signed last week, Sonny. You're signing autographs for 50 a pop. You're paying tonight. So that's that. I'll be real honest. I don't know where this podcast goes from here. We're at 45 minutes.
Well, I'm going to Gatlinburg, Tennessee this next week.
We did talk about
in the Smoky Mountains.
Yeah. Do you have any idea of what you're going to do there?
No idea. So I was going to tell you, look up Gatlinburg and tell me what it's about.
Okay.
I'm guessing that it's a historical town. It sounds historical. Like, right. Gatlinburg just sounds like a war was fought there. A battle was fought there in like 1807.
Right. But wasn't it something else with a burg on it? Gettysburg. That's what it was.
And that was in the Northeast.
That was in, I'm not going to say anything. I was going to say Virginia, but I
think. Gettysburg, Vermont.
Gettysburg. Kevin's laughing at us right now.
Yeah, he would poop on us.
Gettysburg, Pennsylvania is where that is. So, you know what? That's an 0-2 on for Drake and I. That's okay. Not history majors. Gatlinburg, Tennessee. Well, we already looked up Bent Creek Golf Course the other day.
Right. Yeah. Get one in at Bent Creek.
So you're gonna take the clubs.
Yeah, yeah.
You got nice clubs?
Got some pretty decent.
Tell me in the, because there's a lot of people that listen to this thing. We didn't get the golf tournament set up this year. What are you working with for a bag? What kind of clubs?
Okay. For any golf nuts out there, I have a ping answer to like Carson exclusive single block milled putter that I picked up for free off some guy at a pro shop that just gave it to me. He's like, yeah, here, take this. It's an extra. I guess he didn't know what he had. It's worth over $1,000.
The putter is worth a G bomb?
A G bar. Yeah. Because they don't make it. It's a really old putter. It's an original. It's all original. And it's made out of, so they take literally a single block of steel, Kluver, and then they mill out a putter head out of one single block of steel. And
well, that's cool.
So it's pretty cool. Yeah.
Is it heavy?
No, it's a blade putter. It's just got a normal weight to it.
You're going to be in the dead. If you find a golf course, it's going to be up and down.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because you're in the mountains.
Mountains. I'm probably not walking it.
No, fuck no, dude. Look at this.
Make Kaylee carry the bag.
You see that?
Oh, man.
So this is where the city sits. So you see this thing right here? They've got their own space needle.
Yeah.
And then it says on this little map here, there's an aquarium. A sky lift, which I believe is, if we go back one, you can kind of like see. Yeah, look at this thing. You can ride like a.
Oh, yeah. Up the mountains.
Yeah, right here. Like all the way up this mountain here.
It's just a ski lift.
Yeah, but it's just a ride. Like you're not going to ski anywhere. So it's kind of I don't know if there's much else to do in Gatlinburg. Is this
right? It's just a nice place. Last year we got together in the Rocky Mountains in Durango, Colorado. And so now we are going to get together on the East Coast mountains and see what the Smokies have to offer.
Okay.
Maybe someday make it to the Adirondacks.
Never even heard of that. I was going to say the Appalachian.
Yeah. The Adirondacks are in New York, just northeast.
There probably is plenty of moonshine where you're going.
I'm sure that there will be a decent amount of booze drank, but you know, no vitamins or except for CBD, no vitamins are going with me on this trip.
Wow. Because you're trying to, I mean, you're an upstanding citizen.
I'm an upstanding citizen. I'm not going to be staying in an Airbnb rented by Kaylee's family with an illegal substance. That's just not how I roll.
Just can't rip herb in a random Airbnb. So, it looks like I bet. Here's what I will say. I bet there's a couple fire restaurants that you guys end up at.
Oh yeah, I'm sure. And I'll bet there's a couple of very beautiful places that we end up very similar to the Great Smoky Mountains National Park.
Yes. So land-wise, nature-wise, and restaurant-wise, you're probably going to find a lot. Outside of that, I don't think there's shit to do in Tennessee. You got a Space Needle, a Sky Ride, and then you better just enjoy the land and the nature, which is fine because I know that you and Kaylee both like doing that. And it's more about
the folks.
And the people, the company. So that's good.
Did you want me to continue this what's in the bag or not?
I did kind of. Yeah. I'm sure people are interested for those that give a fuck about golf.
All right. And then for my lob wedge and my sand wedge, I rock Cleveland wedges. And then for my gap wedge, I have a Titleist Vokey. For my wedge, just irons wedge through 5-iron, I have TaylorMade P760 blades, forged blades.
This guy's talking about his fucking golf clubs like they were made in King's Landing.
I mean, they're pretty nice set.
It's have you watched any more Game of Thrones?
Yeah, I'm on season 1, episode 8.
A lot of tits, huh?
Yeah, but unfortunately, I already know what happens at the end of the season because one of the episodes, when we clicked on season 1, episode 4, it just showed us season 1, episode 10.
What?
Yeah. So we were like, wait, how did this happen and this happen? Wait, why did they skip all this shit? Like, feels like they could have put a lot of information. And then we finished. I was like, really? And then the next episode we watched, we're like, oh, wait. We watched way ahead on complete accident because the file, because we're watching it on Fire Stick, and the file was just loaded in the wrong spot.
So you know what happens at the end of it.
I know that Khaleesi hatches the 3 eggs and becomes the Dragon Queen.
Okay.
So if that wasn't and Drago died or Drago's like cursed. And he, you know what I'm saying? They try to like bring him back with the witch doctor and the witch doctor's like, well, he's alive. She's like, this is not what I meant.
Fuck. That even sounds like season 2 a little bit. I can't remember.
Ned Stark got his head cut off.
Okay.
Stuck on the stake.
All right. I wasn't sure if you had seen that or heard about that. Spoiler alert, by the way, for anyone who hasn't seen Game of Thrones, but you've had years to watch the show, so you probably skipped ahead already if you're worried about that.
Spoiler alert, I already know what happens at the end of season 7, so I don't give a fuck.
That's true, but there's a lot in between that is just such good TV.
Yeah.
Man, a lot of responses on our top 5 TV shows as well. Several people asking if yours was a joke.
I mean, I've only watched 5 TV shows to completion.
People. And that's what I said. I was like, hey, easy on the judgment here. Clearly, no one has seen all of the shows. So, and then we're still getting responses because it's Twitter of like, wow, very disappointing not to see this. Can't believe you could have a top 5 without this on your list. And somehow everyone's sucking Kevin off. They're like, well, Kevin wins this one. I'll take Kevin. Kevin gets my vote.
Sure.
The hell?
Maybe Kevin has watched a more diverse shows. I don't know.
I don't like that he went off script and went with a 30-minute show at the top. I don't like that he did that.
I mean, 30-minute show. Also, Kevin put Always Sunny as the best show.
I mean, I am a big Always Sunny fan. Like right,
but over Thrones, that right. feels like it totally negates the whole list.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Is you're in my opinion, you're comparing apples to oranges there. Because if I had another list, you're looking at Parks and Rec, South Park, Family Guy, The Office,
Simpsons,
It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, Trailer Park Boy. Like, there's a whole other list that's like of, and it's just not the same. So I don't thoroughly enjoy Kevin breaking the rules. But I guess when you're the fucking CEO Striker, you can do what you want. When you carry the company card, you do what you want. How many steaks do you think he eats? He's just smacking ribeye all the time.
I wish I could see the bill for the food and liquor that he's been comped by Striker.
Yep. Same.
Because you know, it's not a little amount.
You know what we need is you, me, Kev, and the ladies need a company dinner at a nice steakhouse.
Okay, so here's what I'm thinking. Here, now listen to this. I was listening to a podcast, and I don't know how crazy you want to get here, right? Like, do we just dump the budget?
Well, hold on a second now. We still got fucking bills to pay. And
okay.
Well, we don't have bills to pay, but.
Because I was listening to a podcast the other day.
I mean, how expensive were we talking?
And I was learning about Michelin stars.
Oh, here we go.
A one Michelin star rating means that you should absolutely stop and eat there if it is within, you know, a reasonable. If it's like you're going to go to any restaurant, and you're just in an area.
It's worth going out of your way. Yeah.
The Michelin star two means that you need to go out of your way and inconvenience yourself just to eat there. And a Michelin star three, which there's only 14 of them in the United States, you literally should travel to that location simply for that meal.
Wow.
So maybe we just get a little more Keishwan, and then we just blow the budget on an all-time vacation Michelin star three meal.
Oh, God. Michelin guide. Hold on. Michelin guide. One to three stars. But dude, we got to be careful with where we go. Cause a lot of these places, they got shit that looks like art that they're putting on a plate and the portion size is trash and it's.
Yeah, but it's a bazillion courses.
That's true.
Listen, Kaylee and I did dark dining and the meal was vegan. And we didn't know it until afterwards.
Dark dining?
Dark dining in Los Angeles. You go, I've never told you about dark dining.
No.
Dude, you go in and it's complete sensory deprivation. Complete what? And utter darkness. I'm talking about put your palm in front of your face and you will hit your nose. And then they have very loud music playing so that you can't hear the conversations with anybody except for the person at your table. And so you go through this 9-course meal prepared by a chef and you have zero clue what's on it.
Oh, I don't like that.
You can't see it. So you have to smell it and you just have to taste it and try and decide what it is. Use your palate. And Kaylee said she loved it so much that the next time we go back to Vegas for a UFC fight, she doesn't want to go to another one of the amazing restaurants in Vegas. She wants to go back to Dark Dining and try their next season's menu.
Wow. I've got it pulled up here.
It's that crazy.
I don't know if I like,
you have to step outside your comfort zone, bro, because in no way is it comfortable in right. that restaurant for that amount of time. You walk into the restaurant, your server has night vision goggles on.
Oh my God.
And the night vision goggle server then has you do like the Congo line with hands on shoulders to your table. And then he says, okay, I've walked you to your seat. Your chair is on your right. Reach out with your right hand. Reach forward a little bit. Okay, there's your chair. Then he sits down. He's like, okay, here's how your silverware and your cup is oriented. So please like place your palms in front of you. And then I will guide. I will like use direction clues to guide your hands so you know where everything is at.
I'm like, on their website. This is
crazy ridiculous. Experience.
What the hell? An extraordinary mouth-watering culinary journey designed to arouse your palate. Are they trying to fuck you in this place?
I'll tell you what, dude. They gave me a vegan shrimp, crab cake. It was a vegan crab cake with like dill tartar sauce on there. And the waiter said that I got 9 out of the 10 ingredients right, and I was the closest anybody's ever been to it. I felt very culinary minded.
You big dick the experience.
My palate was on point on that one.
Man. This is interesting. Oh my God, they do conga line you. It feels a little bit like escape roomy.
Wait, can you see the inside of the restaurant? Because we wonder what the inside of the restaurant looks like.
The walls, but I mean, not really. No.
Yeah.
What the hell? And you did you go to this place called Blackout?
Yes.
Was it expensive?
About $75 a plate. But like I said, it was 9 courses the second time and 11 courses the first time. And it was
11 courses?
Yeah, man. A lot of it was hors d'oeuvres.
And you're putting
there was only one main course.
Oh my God. Dude, here's the thing. This will never happen unless I'm with like you or somebody.
Right.
Because Lauren barely likes food when she can see it and smell it. And that's when she's not pregnant. If she had to do this in the dark, she doesn't even like her food touching on her plate.
Oh, the food isn't touching on the plate.
Well, yeah, because there's only one little serving.
And they also use unique platings so that like, some of the plates are shaped like a clover leaf, and they'll say, okay, and then your left clover, this is like the texture you'll find. So you might want to use your spoon in the left clover, but in the right clover, you can use your fingers. And in the top, you might use your fork for that one. And then in the center of the clover, the main thing is a sauce that you can dip each of them in or something of that nature, you know?
Wow. You have never told me about this.
Yeah, I've done it a couple times.
Well, we went from charity events and taco bars to extortion to back around to eating in the dark.
And I'm about to go have me some quesabria tacos. And
wow, that sounds so good.
It's unbelievable, dude. The taco truck up the street for me is a 5-star Yelp taco truck, and it is actually 5 doors down. It's parked in the gas station that is 5 doors away from me.
Wow.
So I eat there about twice a day every day, and that's that.
That's unbelievable. We got to get them to sponsor us. I am not going to be eating quesabria.
Dude, I'm getting thick.
Yeah, dude, you're putting on the weight. I got my ass slapped in disc golf today, by the way.
Your brother beat you?
Austin, we've been pretty close. Like yesterday.
How much money did he take off you today?
None.
You but don't gamble on the golf course?
I don't feel comfortable at disc golf yet enough for me to gamble against my brother who's been playing for 2 years.
Pussy.
He was -5 and I was +6.
Yikes. That sounds like me and Kaylee on the mini putt course.
So he worked me, and that's okay because he has played a lot more, but it didn't feel great. And but that's okay because I'm gonna bury my sorrows with Culver's. It's Sunday night in the Kluver household. A fat triple butter burger is incoming. And
did you say triple Butterburger?
Yes, dude.
So it's, when you go to Culver's, you play exactly zero games.
I am not fucking around. When I go,
I've never ordered a triple Butterburger in my whole life.
Let me tell you about how greasy it is.
Now, I've ordered a lot of spicy chicken fingers from there.
Oh. Dude, and when you dunk that grease dripping meat into the ranch that they have.
Ranch, they've got a unique ranch.
They do, and it's over. It's over. Call your grandma. Tell her you're going to bed.
Do you get the curders?
Of course I get the curds for the side. And you know I'm getting a fucking
mixie. Hey, you want to know something? Kaylee and I made homemade mixies last night. We got sweetened condensed milk, evaporated milk. We got heavy whipping cream, which I then took a fork and whisked for about 15 minutes until it got stiff peaks.
You don't have a beater?
Mixed, and then, no, it's packed away. No. It's packed away in the storage unit.
Oh, okay.
We're living bare minimum.
Oh, you're a minimalist right now, huh?
Yeah. We're in an 800 square foot, single bedroom.
Skunked out.
Single bathroom. Well, the skunk smell is starting to fade.
Okay, good.
Yeah. And by starting to fade, I mean, it's like pretty much faded.
Awesome.
But
where you fucking hand whip
cream. Yeah. Dude, I'm talking, we did this Amish style, bro. Wow. Loaded it up in a skillet because we don't have any cake pans because they're all packed away to freeze.
Oh, so okay.
It had the biggest surface area. We loaded up two bowls and a skillet. Like a frying skillet, and loaded those up in the freezer. Then got mini Oreos and Reese's Big Cups. And I took the chocolate rim off the Reese's Big Cups and put two full Big Cups worth of peanut butter in my homemade ice cream. I may never buy ice cream anywhere ever again. It was unbelievable.
It's so good. And when you eat something that you made, it is amazing. But dude, like, it is so much work.
Yeah, but it was worth the work.
I know. We have a, for our wedding, we got an ice cream, the ice cream maker attachment to a KitchenAid mixer. So you just pour your batter in there and it just.
Dude, have you ever tasted sweetened condensed milk?
Yes.
Holy shit.
It's unbelievable.
That is toaster strudel icing.
Yeah. It's one of it. I'm pretty sure one of the Jenny flavors has like a sweetened condensed cream sauce or something in it. That's sweetened condensed milk is like a top five reason why obesity is a thing. That's like, it's so good. It doesn't even make sense.
Dude, I just had an idea. Before I go to Gatlinburg tomorrow,
yeah,
I'm going to get 2 dozen crumble cookies to take with us so that the whole family can have at least one cookie.
Shit, actually, the new flavors come out like right now.
Drop the flavors on me, Daddy.
I don't know if they're out yet, but they're probably in our Discord. Let me... because we're not going to get to talk about them on...
Dude, can you imagine how big of a hero I would be showing up with 2 dozen crumbles?
Oh, you'd be an absolute king.
All right. Well, I got to do it, right? Because I just got to always be everybody's favorite.
Sometimes you have to be that guy.
When you don't enforce your parents' rules and you don't have rules of your own, it's just like, and you bring crumble cookies? I'm Santa Claus.
It sounds like it. Usually they're in DHT, right? Is where they drop those. That one guy always drops the flavors early.
I think so, yeah.
Oh, we got Sam Wieskamp up in the Discord.
Is that right?
Okay. What's up, Sam?
Shout out to the Wieskamps, man. Joe's getting married July 30th, and I can't make it because I'm going to be driving my ass in a U-Haul across the country. So that's tough.
Damn.
But
are you ready for these flavors?
Yeah. Hit me.
Chocolate crumb cake featuring Oreo.
Whew.
Oatmeal chocolate chip.
Yo.
Chocolate Mallow cupcake, fruit pizza, and maple glaze.
Yikes.
Maple glaze, bro?
Oh, man. Crumble's about to get
absolutely vaporize tomorrow. I'm going to delete a couple cookies.
You're going to extort your stomach with some crumble cookies.
Real deal.
Wow. All right. Somehow, like I said, Drake and I found some shit to talk. We went for like an hour and 6 minutes. No Hawkeye content, but hey, this is an Iowa Hawkeye podcast for the family, right? We talk about the hard-hitting issues.
Listen, we're the kings of the Iowa football podcasting, and that's that. Irregardless of all our content, it's Iowa football related. When it comes to an Iowa football associated podcast, well, actually, they probably want to have zero association with us. So,
true.
A podcast that involves Iowa football, we're the kings, and that's that.
Peace.